Cinderella. She lived in a big hark douse with her two sissy uglers and her mean old mepstother. Are you catching on? We'll see. One day as she was flopping the moor, that's... her two sissy uglers came running in and said, "The Pransom Hints is throwing a fancy breast drawl, and we're all invited, but gee, it's boo-tad Cinderella, you just can't go." So thust about Jen, Cinderella went running in the kitchen with ears in her ties, that's... she was just about ready to chickasee a frickin'. When all of a sudden there was a lightning flash flight, and standing in front of her was a beautiful berry. Cinderella said, "You are who, and what in the who do you want?" The beautiful berry said, "I'm your Mary Fodgather." It wasn't a Mary Fodgather, it was a Rich Hitch Rigby, all dressed up as her hairy godmother. Cinderella said, "Oh, Mary Fodgather, may I go to the fancy breast drawl?" Her hairy godmother said, "Certainly." So instantly, Cinderella was transformed into a babishing Rudy. She had on a long white Gatton Sound necklace of poopies and merles. And on her feet were two tiny sass glippers. And she was off. Soon she cast to the camel, that's came to the castle, and the first people she met were the two sissy uglers, but she was so beautiful, they didn't even cinderize Reckonella. So, they took her to the Pransom Hints. He said, "Wow, may I dab this Hints? For she is so beautiful, she reminds me of the beeping Slooty." I don't have dyslexia. I worked hard to memorize his story. He was just about ready to ask for her Marin Handage when all of a sudden the stock card strikes 12, Cinderella banned from the roll. But as she was doing so, one of the tiny sass clippers flipped from her soot. So the Pransom Hints went over, picked it up, said, "As soon as I find out whose soot this flipper sits, I will know with whom I have lollin' in fove." It's a love story. So the dairy vexnay, he went from house to house, pillar to post. Those can't be turned around. He wanted to find out whose soot the flipper sat. He came to Cinderella's house. He tried the flipper on the first sis juggler. It fiddin' did. He tried it on the second sis juggler, and again it. And then it was Cinderella's turn. We all know the flipper pitted perfectly, and the Pransom Hints and Cinderella were married and have to live ever after. What do we need to learn in this beautiful story? Never give up. Benjamin Franklin never gave up. Thomas Jefferson never gave up. Melaleuca and Herbalife ought to give up. Thank you. So, always remember, if you're ever at a fancy breast drawl, to slop your dripper. Don't try to memorize that story, because after a while you get all messed up and you start to stink that way. But Cinderella's life went from pathetic to perfect. Why? She never lost the thought that she had the potential to be a princess. My life, when I was about this tall, well, I still am, but when I was a young boy, my life was perfect. I grew up in a very small community in central Utah. Three brothers, three sisters. I woke up every day. I looked out at the magnificent mountains and the wide open spaces, and I knew in my soul that life was full of infinite possibilities. My dad was a high school basketball coach. I was being primed by my dad to be this exceptional athlete. I grew to be about 5'10" tall. I was 15 years old. My best friends were Roger and Phil and Doug. We'd listen to the Beatles, chase girls, play sports. We were all looking forward to getting our driver's licenses. And on this particular Friday, my best friends, it happened to be Veterans Day, they were waiting for me at Lake Ridge Junior High School. The entire school and community, they were all excited about the championship football game the next morning. So I fixed my little sister Julie's flat bike tire. I ran down the street, crossed the road, jumped up the curb, dashed to the grass, bounced up onto the cement porch, and I started banging on the old screen door. Tori, another friend and teammate, said, "Mike, come in, come in, come on in." So I opened the door, I walked towards my friend's voice. I found him in his mom and dad's bedroom. Nobody was home. I plopped down on the white bedspread. I was facing this very direction. Tori walked towards me holding a gun in a brown leather case. "Mike, I like to play around with this gun when my mom and dad aren't home. This is my dad's off-duty police gun. I know where he hides it when he goes to work." I was curious. I listened. Tori took the gun out of the brown leather case, flipped the cylinder that holds the bullets out to the side, and he started shaking the gun. I watched 4 little silver bullets fall right next to me on the white bedspread. I could have reached out and picked them up. I started doing math in my head. I got to 4. I wondered, how many bullets does that gun hold anyway? I should have said something. This was an accident. Tori thought he had an empty gun 3 feet away, pulled it up to his hip, pointed it at my chest. Bang. I remember that day. The bullet hit my chest, punctured my right lung, missed my heart, hit my spine, slammed me back onto that white bedspread. I passed out. Tori freaked out. I was regaining my consciousness. I was trying to breathe. I thought, this can't be real. But my friends here today, these things are real, aren't they? Death, divorce, failure. And as I tried to take another breath, I thought, this is real. I've really been shot. My legs won't respond. My friends freaking out. I started promising God, if I can live, I'll change. I'll be a better person. I will help as many people in this world as I can. I just want to live. I passed out again. The next thing I remember, Tori was hovered over me, had a hold of my, "Mike, you're faking it, you're faking it." I pulled up my shirt, showed him the hole in my chest. He ran back over to the blue phone that was on the wall that I had desperately wanted to get to, but I was glued to that white bedspread. He called my home telephone number. My incredible mother answered. "Mrs. Schlappi, come quick. Mike's been hurt." Threw the phone in the corner. Ran back in the kitchen. The next 2 minutes were the longest of my life, but I hung in there. Why? I had hope that my mom would show up. You know what? I have a gut feeling there's a couple moms in this audience. I want you to know you matter. You make a difference. When my mom walked in that bedroom, you do. Thank you. My mom walked over to me, touched my hand, touched my face, ran her fingers through my hair. I believe my mom saved my life. She ran back over to that same blue phone, called 911. Can you imagine how my friend's dad felt? He's cruising the neighborhood in his police car. It came across his radio. There had been a shooting at his address. Ambulances show up. They rush me to the hospital. The body is an amazing creation, isn't it? It is. You know what saved me? Besides my mom, my friend, the doctors and nurses, my heart. Was on inbeat. That very split second, the bullet sped by. I spent 8 days in intensive care. That bullet was lodged in my spine, tubes in my nose and into my lungs, all kind of pain, in and out of consciousness. My girlfriend dumped me 3 days later. It's all right, I found a new one, but hi. Local newspaper said, "Boy shoots himself. Father leaves loaded revolver on nightstand. Star athlete, student body president clinging to life." Tori was obviously scared. I'd be lying to you if I didn't tell you there were times I wanted to just reach over there and pull the plug out of the wall and end it all. Why didn't I? Good people like you were there for me.